So it's now just to see why it doesn't. So does it flip as well? Do you see the second slide?
Yes.
So this is the yeast cell, and you have a mother and the daughter. So one thing with aging is that it's driven by damage. And this is a universal evolutionary case, conserved, so it's from bacteria over yeast to mammalian systems. The older you are, basically, the more damage you have. As I already mentioned, this phenomenon was discovered in yeast in 2003 with the Nystrom group. And it coincided a bit with me starting my PhD in 2005 in Germany, where the idea was to mathematically kind of study this process and this asymmetry in damage accumulation. So you can see here that the damage in the, you can see, so it's a damage in the mother cell is mainly preserved while the cell is young, while the older the cell, this damage starts to leak. So it's, and then what they show basically the bud scars, so that mark of how old you are coincides very well with the amount of damage. And this is particular damage that was mentioned, that was modeled, or it was observed in this work was it's a carbonylated protein, so it's oxidatively damaged type of damage. So I started studying this as a PhD student, and I really liked the topic, and I did a postdoc in something completely different in metabolic engineering. But when I got my position at MAT after the postdoc, I kind of came back to aging and picking it up from there. So this is how we started in the group, laying foundation basically of this process on a more kind of complete level. And we is Nick who was performing experiments, and Johannes and Barbara that were developing a model. So we started first of describing the model of replicative aging on a single cell level. So you can imagine that you have a cell, there is a number of proteins there, and the older the cell is, the proteins are getting more and more damaged, which we show here with the darker colors. And obviously during the process, the yeast cell is dividing within the budding process. And when it divides, it leaves this bud scar mark on the surface of the mother cell. So what Johannes did together with Barbara is to develop basically how this damage and intact protein interplay is happening. So it's a very simple model. It's two differential equations that you have, and with the P is like the intact proteins and D were the damaged proteins. And you have like processes that are really universal. You have a cell growth, you have a damage formation and the damage repair. And the idea here is when we build those models, we work with yeast as we could test this in the lab and we could derive the data. But to make the models more general and to have these processes on a little bit higher level, it's always the idea that you can easily adapt them for other systems as well. So we kind of approached with that. And then in order for because you want to describe the replicative aging, obviously you have to take into account it's not just the dynamics of the protein that goes between in this direction, but it's also that this cell divides, what happens, how when the division happens, what happens further with the cell. So what we did, we have a algebraic basically equations that describe this movement of damaged protein that leaks to the daughter cell that was experimentally observed. So the beginning daughters are born damage free, and then the older they are, or the older the mother is, the more damage that the daughters inherit as well. This was kind of a bit more developed than the model that I did as a PhD student. So it was just putting it more on the single cell level. But then the interesting thing what Barbara observed is that in literature, usually we know that the cell, the organisms are aging, there are many processes that are getting worse and worse and lose functionality. However, with the damage repair, it was always considered in these aging models that they are continuous, so that the organism repairs damage at the same rate throughout the life. So what Barbara did actually wanted to test two different scenarios. So it's this function with the sine function here is that you first scenario is this what I just said, it's unlimited capacity of the cell to repair damage. And then if you take a half of the sine function, so just this like a first loop, then you have this that the cell reaches like a peak in the capacity to repair, and that will probably decline towards the death. And then we could steer this slope actually how fast you repair at the beginning. So it was really convenient function to play with and then see different strategies. If you repair damage very fast at the beginning and release it towards the end, or if it's better if you have the slower pace here and then maybe increase it at the mid of your life. So we look at different scenarios that you will see, always comparing these two different damage repair strategies. So having this single cell model, there are also a few things that I didn't explain in the first slide, and there are three kind of main components. And the first one here is this Q that appears, and it's resilience to damage. When you build a plain model, what you usually do for the ordinary differential equations, you can use tools from physics that it's something that is called non-dimensionalization. And this is basically a way to get rid of the units and work in more like you can think about like if you normalize your samples, basically, and then you see the differences clearly. But then in doing this, there are many properties that pop up. And then this was this Q that we coined as the resilience to damage. And it's basically the quotient between the cell death and cell division. So it's like the amount of proteins that you have when you are dead and the amount that it's like allows you to divide. It can also be interpreted as the capacity of the cell to cope with the damage, how well you respond to this. And when doing the experiments, what we realized that this is actually corresponds to the increase in size of an old to a young cell. So Nick, we use a lot of microfluidics devices to work with the singles to isolate the single cells. And then we could extrapolate young cells on the single cell level as well as the old cell. And then you see these peaks, these are like that they go into division. So these are first three divisions here, and here are the last few divisions of the cell. From there, basically from this data, we estimated this Q parameter, so the resilience to damage. When you plug in different values just to test, we were basically looking, so it's for the low levels of Q, the cell would define the replicative lifespan would be only 5, then the bigger the Q is, then it's a kind of increases. And what is also interesting, what you observe, because this looks like a stair, is the length of the stairs basically corresponds to the length of the cell cycle, and it's also coincided very well that the older the cell is, the longer the cell cycle is, what is the fact that we already knew. So this was a really nice confirmation. Then in actual algebraic equation, there are two key parameters is that you have to account for the cell size. We know that it's a asymmetrical division where the mother is 3 times approximately larger than its daughter. So it was very easy because there are data for this. But then there is also a damage retention mechanism that allows basically this, that the mother at the beginning keeps the damage for herself that somehow leaks further. So it's a active mechanism that we assume, and it's also introduced as a parameter in the algebraic equation. And then this replicative lifespan that I already mentioned is simply the measure of age in yeast. So it's how many times it divides, then you estimate the age. So the advantage of being kind of at math is that you can and having a theoreticians in the group that you could play with the model itself and the structure on a little bit deeper level and simply simulating and plugging in like sensitivity analysis, but you can actually look deeper into how different parameters are connected and what do they actually mean. And by doing this, Johannes derived this inequality here that basically places the retention in the center of attention and how the retention is basically related to the resilience to damage to the cell size and to the damage itself. And having this in hand, we could ask then a little bit more interesting questions like how much damage can a mother cell retain How does the capacity to retain this type of damage will change with the age? What are the factors that would limit this, and the degree of asymmetry? How actually mother, what is the maximal ratio that the mother can be larger than its daughter in order to affect this damage retention? Hmm? So these are the key kind of properties that we are looking. So what we could see as a first result is that the capacity to retain damage decreases as the amount of damage would increase in the cell. So it's intuitive. But also what came out is very interesting thing is that if you, the more resources you invest to retain damage, so assume that at the beginning it's very easy to keep damage at the mother because there is not that much damage that is built in anyhow. But the more damage mother cell is building, you have to basically actively push for the damage retention to be in place and to hold this damage for the mother cell. But this comes at the cost of lowering degree of resilience to damage for the individual cell. Hmm? Then what's a really interesting thing that was a follow-up here is that actually the fact that you can retain damage is a byproduct of being asymmetrical. You could see here that if you plug in a purely symmetrical cell, so it's like a half that they split at half, this will kind of become zero, and then there is no retention happening. So it's purely from equation that came in. So we could see that the basically the effect of this retention coefficient and with the size proportion, so it's everything that is higher. So you could see derive the theoretical maximal retention and theoretical maximal size proportion of the cell that is related to the resilience to damage. And we observe, obviously, it was clear from this graph that the retention is proportional to the degree of symmetry, and we could derive what would that be depending on the capacity to resilience to damage. And then we could see that theoretical maximal degree of asymmetry was 0.8, so it would correspond that the mother is like 80% of the whole entity when they divide. So when you have the single cell model and we could basically, this was rather theoretical study, one can say. There were kind of experiments also there confirming some of the findings and deriving the data for the model. But then the question came as like how the aging of this individual cell would fit into the aging of the whole population, basically, because usually with the aging, what we did before and before the single cell studies came out, you look at this from the population perspective and you take the average cell and then you infer everything from there. But the idea here was now how we can now build a proper, if you have an individual cell that is inferred the whole population, and this is what Barbara did. So we allow basically each cell now to divide, so you deeper down into the tree. And obviously not all cells are equal in the population, but it's also something that is known. There is a high level of variability. And there is a really interesting tool that it's used from the pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamic study where they investigate effects of the drugs it's called the non-linear mixed effect modeling, where you basically introduce the variability in certain parameters. And it's exactly what Barbara did. So she introduced the individuality in the cell growth, damage formation and damage repair, basically. So you could have a normal distribution, and then you draw basically from those things. So you have a clear, you have an ODE model, differential equation model, but you on top of that, you give for some parameters, they don't have fixed values, but you give the probability function baby and then draw from that. There are certain effects that we keep constant, and then these three effects that we keep to vary between the individuals. When we derive this whole platform, then there is like a cool stuff can come up. And then it's first thing is to investigate how what is the effect of the retention on the basically the whole population. And then we could see you have a bigger populations with the retention. So you can see here, and it's again, the color coding is the same. So you have a decline in repair and then unlimited in brownish. So at the beginning, if you imagine that the retention is zero, the population is very low, and then with a very high retention rate, this dramatically increases. So retention itself allows you to have a much bigger populations. And then you can see the size ratios basically here that would correspond to the zero retention and the high, very high retention. You can also see how little basically effect this repair has because it fluctuates a lot. But what is also interesting that the retention basically lowers the damage at birth, because this is really important that you give offsprings that they don't have a lot of damage. You want them to be free, damage free, and that they are healthy. So you could see that, for example, if you would simply compare, now zooming in, so this is more kind of effect of the parameters, but if you would look separately for the unlimited repair capacity and the decline in the repair capacity, you could see that this decline lowers the damage basically up in the in the daughter cell, and while also lowering down the damage in the mother cell. You can see the clear differences up here. So you have for the case of retention, and then in the non-retention case, the separation of the mother and the daughter is much lower simply because they divide, because you don't allow this damage to be retained. But then also what having this population or the framework for simulating every single cell, you could now basically go deep in the tree and dissect each cell and get some properties. So we could have these lineage positions here. So we define this as the position 124 will be that it's the first daughter of the mother that is a 24th kid of her own mother, kind of. So you basically have a up to the grandmother. So this is how you see this. And then we could select a number of properties. So you have properties here for the individual cell that we were measuring, and then you could also infer the properties of the whole population. And these are some of the things that I'm going now to go into a bit more details. So each dot here represents one cell in the population. And again, we look at this when you have ability to retain and when you don't have ability to retain, and looking two different capacities. And the properties that we see are generation time, growth per cell cycle, damage at birth, and size at birth, basically, and how this changes with each individual cell towards within the population. And you can see that if you have retention, the first kind of pops up that it's a bit of the lower variability, and that they all kind of a black and white 0-1 if you compare these two. So it's a really dramatic effect if you have unlimited or decline in repair capacity. You don't have to kind of look at the specific details here, because the more interesting things will come, and this is particularly important that if you have a retention, you decrease the significantly variability between your cells across the whole lineages, which is kind of very very clear if you look at the replicative potential. And those that have the retention divide have a higher replicative potential than those that would not have retention. And then there is also a difference if you have unlimited repair capacity and no retention, your populations were significantly smaller than those, for example, with the same no retention but with a decline. And it's like even not, it's significantly better if you have retention and any of the repair capacities. And this allows us basically to look at the two things that you were really interested a lot in the group, and this is like rejuvenation phenomena is one. So Barbara defined this index. So for each cell in the population, you can define this rejuvenation index. And it can, if it's zero, then there is nothing. So that means basically position 1-1, you are the first daughter of your mother, was also first child of its own mother. And then you all both have the same basically ability to divide 24 times. So this index was zero. If like you are 24th child of mother that is a first child, then you could, you as a child divide only 10 times compared to your mother, and then you have a negative index because you reduced your own lifespan compared to your mother's lifespan. And then if you look at the opposite case, that you are the first child of the mother that was a 24th child, and that mother had only 10 kids, but you yourself as a first child could have 24 daughters, then it's considered to be a positive rejuvenation index. So these are the three scenarios that that Barbara looked, and then you can have, so it's in red, we have a negative rejuvenation index, and then we have in the light blue, it has a positive rejuvenation index. So you can again follow these properties for each individual cell, and even though this might look better kind of in a non-retention case with decline, that they kind of rejuvenate much more, but it's also that you could look at this negative rejuvenation is much more spread than it comes already in the early cells, while if you have a retention with a decline in repair capacity, there are very few cells that exhibit negative rejuvenation factors. So it's the argument here, it's better that there are more cells are better off than if you have a smaller pool that is doing really bad and everything else is doing really poorly. So even though there's not many cells we observe with a positive rejuvenation, the majority of the cells is exhibiting very slight or are in the kind of the same effect as their mothers. And then the other thing that we are really interested in this health span. So we all, if you come from our perspective of humans, we live longer if you compare 30, 40 years ago. However, we are not necessarily healthier and you can end up, if you're retired, you can end up in a hospital basically for the rest of your retirement. So we wanted to investigate this in yeast, how much we can push yeast to divide when it's healthy. So it had produces only kind of healthy offspring. So it's when it contains a lot of damage, basically you should stop dividing and then you should just kind of disappear. So we had this health span measure again that Barbara defined, and this is kind of interpreted at low damage levels as long as possible. So basically to keep them as low as possible, and then within the same time divide as much as possible, because this will ensure that your offsprings are good. So doing this, it was really surprising result. So it's like shocking almost to see when the retention is in place that you have such a difference in different repair strategies. So basically, unlimited repair capacity doesn't allow for any health span. Basically, it's really deleterious for the whole population. And it's the worst basically scenario that you can have, even though you have quite a lot of cells in the population, they don't manage, they don't cope well with the damage and division at the same time. While this decline in the repair capacity showed the moderate health span. So the measure is that they were capable, all cells in the population, to keep up and produce fresh and healthy offsprings. So that's kind of the main conclusions that we had from these studies. And if you want basically to, so I mean, you observe this, but then you want further kind of to understand the mechanism. So this is what actually Barbara went into the model and saw what is happening here. So it's why those cells show such a different behavior if you have unlimited and unlimited care, capacity to repair. So she looked again, this is the figure that I already showed, that this health span basically how it depends on the retention. And again, the color coding is the same. And you could see basically that they show the generation time is increasing in the case of decline in the repair capacity. And this, of course, now going back, the wider generation time is increasing because the damage at birth are lower. And then this again goes back to this slide where the separation of the mother and the daughter in terms of how much damage they contain, and especially in the case of the decline in repair capacity. So it's basically ability of the cell to retain and decline and have a lot of repair at the beginning allows them to have a population that contains of mainly healthy cells. I will now quickly go. I have two more minutes just to show you that we are now doing this from the damage perspective, but also we are looking this from the nutrient sensing and metabolism, because you know this all ability that if you are caloric restrict yourself, you should live longer. And this is like a long known fact that was discovered in yeast. So Linnaeus is doing this together with Sebastian and Nick, and again, it's microfluidics that it's in place. And we look at this from a different perspective. We combine Boolean and FBA models together with the OD models on the single cell level. What Linnea did, she had a big Boolean network of the key nutrient sensing pathways in place, and then she basically derived the Boolean representation of it, and then further combined it with the FBA model of central carbon metabolism in yeast to see interplay between signaling and metabolism. And with doing this, it was non-trivial basically to combine these processes on happening on different scales. What she did is basically bridge them via transcriptional layer that would feed back into the metabolic layer. You could look at the growth, you could see the in the fermentation and respiration how this affects. What we could observe is changes in lifespan during the caloric restriction that depends directly. So you manipulate the glucose intake in the cell and evaluate the metabolic response there. Sebastian looked at this from more single cell perspective and looking at the mechanistic level. Basically derived the delayed ODE model combining the nonlinear mixed effect. And then he could also simulate a bunch of deletions there and basically see how the recovery and the long-term glucose response would affect cells. Very last thing that we were also interested, because this division plays a really big role in how you on the yeast and its cell polarization is the mechanism that basically is relevant for everyone. It's like allows you to grow limbs and so on. So we derived the PDE model, partial differential equation model of cell polarization. And it's the one of the first models where we assume that the cell in 3D, which if you're a biologist, this may be something, of course, that you will assume that, what is it? But from the math perspective, cells were usually assumed to be aligned. And the reason for that is not that they are stupid, but because computationally, this is very difficult to assume, manipulate the processes on a 3D scale. So we had a really good collaboration with other groups in math that are working with the spatial models. And there is a colleague there that builds these twin cities. So he's building the Gothenburg in silico, basically. So he works a lot with the 3D structures. So we approached him and told him, like, we want to simulate the sphere. And of course, for him, this was nothing because he builds a whole city in 3D. So we build the event of this so-called symmetry breaking event, where the polarization should happen then when you have this accumulation of CDC42. And this is now coupled how the cell could coordinate growth and division further on. So it's a three-dimensional bulk surface model of the CDC42 mediated cell polarization. When you can get the polarization at the B, so it's not all parameter space. So it's also very theoretical work that Johannes did. And it's picked up now with Sebastian and Patrick, that Patrick is performing experiments and Sebastian is doing further on the modeling. And he could basically couple this to the increased gap activity that in old cells prolongs the polarization time. And then, of course, it will be affected on the generation time of the cell. So it's now ongoing kind of work. And in order to build these models, this is my last slide, is basically we work, as you could notice, a lot with the single cell. We don't have a framework for this from the theoretical perspective. So Sebastian is now building a state-based mixed effect inference framework that basically allows you to combine both intrinsic and intrinsic noise fitting the models on the single cell time-lapse data. This is something really that will help us, because the further goal is basically to build large-scale kinetic models on the single cell level, which we don't have the platform, we don't have a framework, mathematical tools for this. We hope that this will be something interesting, and this will be useful not just for us basically, but for many others. Mm-hmm. Obviously, this work is done with many people. I mentioned few. it's the core of the group, and we have a lot of bachelor and the master students, and some are now involved in Godbin as well, that pass through the group. And it's really, really nice to be involved in also educating people in the computational biology and be involved in the master program and in other activities.